Good morning, everyone. It's about 11:40 on the 22nd of January 2017. So welcome to podcast, which is titled Hermetic Kabbalah, Part 2, Nakash. So in my previous podcast, I broadly covered the subject of Partsufim theory, just as a kind of an introduction to the more serious, in-depth subject of Partsufim theory. So if you haven't already looked at that before starting to look at the next bunch of podcasts, you might want to go back and have a look at that previous podcast number 5. So in the Partsufim theory, I discussed the 6 primary intelligences, which are the foundation of the human mind and which govern the human mind. So in this podcast and the 5 which will follow after it, I'm going to cover the subjects of each of those individual Partsufim in detail. And I'm going to do this because I believe that Partsufim theory is one of the most important subjects in Hermetic Kabbalah, and it's also the subject which there is least known about. Now, when you meet people who are keen students of Hermetic Kabbalah and start discussing things about Kabbalah with them, often you'll find that the thing that they know the least about is Partsufim theory. So we're going to cover each of those, and in this first podcast we're going to cover the subject of Nakash, and then I'm going to work my way up through the Tree of Life, each of the Partsufim in the order that they ascend in to the highest level of the human mind. This is an important subject because it revolves around the concept of esoteric psychology, and that directly relates to the subject of initiation, which is one of the first important things that people need to understand about if they want to know how to productively approach the study of Hermetism. So let's begin by pointing out that in Kabbalah, historically speaking, the guys, the Kabbalists or the rabbis or whatever you want to call them, who originally laid down the structure of Kabbalah, how it was formed as a body of knowledge and then how that body of knowledge was passed on, they often made use of 2 important mechanisms where preserving their knowledge and passing it on was concerned. And these 2 important mechanisms are the creation of symbolic stories and the creation of dialogue catechisms, which are basically artificial conversations between 2 or more people. They may be artificial conversations or they may be based on actual conversations which took place, but usually they're symbolic. And we see these 2 mechanisms all through the Hermetic tradition. Stories, which are kind of metaphorical or allegorical, which are designed to convey life lessons or instructions about how things work, where the nature of reality is concerned. And catechisms are the same. They're like a discussion between 2 or more people where one person is asking questions about a particular subject or a number of related subjects, and somebody who understands the answers to those questions and the nature of those subjects will reply to them. So these stories and these catechisms can be generally grouped into 4 levels of understanding. In other words, there are 4 kinds of ways that these esoteric Kabbalistic stories have been designed to be understood. And there are more than 4 ways, but I am going to primarily focus on these main 4 ways of looking at these Kabbalistic stories and Hermetic stories in general. So the first level that these coded or symbolic stories can be understood is to look at them as being descriptions, symbolic descriptions of the mechanics of collective human psychology. In other words, they're explaining how the psyche of humanity works on a large scale and on a collective kind of a level. The second level is to see these stories as being descriptions of pseudo-history. In other words, they may or may not use actual events in history as the kind of basis for the construction of these stories, or they may be completely made up historic events. Whether they are true or not is not the point. The point is to relate these historic events to other areas of esoteric knowledge in order to explain that human history in a very physical and literal way is related to other more abstract mechanisms in human society. The third level of understanding that we can read into these encoded or symbolic hermetic or Kabbalistic stories is on the level of personal human psychology. In other words, we can look at these stories and we can understand through them how a person's individual mind functions and operates. And the fourth level that we're going to look at is the alchemical level, and that is that all of these stories, or a very good large portion of them, all contain symbolic references to alchemical formula or mechanisms. So let me quickly go over that again. The first level is collective human psychology. The second level is pseudo-historical. The third level is personal individual psychology. And the fourth level is to see these stories as explaining things about how the alchemical mechanism pervades all of nature. The reason why these stories were used as ways of teaching information and these dialogue catechisms was because they are a very easy way of memorizing and then passing on information in a relatively accurate fashion. When you're relying largely on an oral tradition for preserving esoteric information, repeating stories and then afterwards explaining what each of the symbols in the story means in a literal fashion is a very easy way of preserving and passing on information in a relatively accurate way. So we see this whole mechanism right through the Hermetic tradition, dialogue catechisms and symbolic kind of stories about things. There is another level that we can read into these stories and catechisms, and that is the level of the common or popular interpretation of what these stories mean, or the literal interpretation. And that level of understanding of these stories is designed only for the average person who is not an initiate, with the intention that they won't understand what the underlying esoteric meaning is, but they will appreciate the stories on a more superficial level, and then they can be largely drafted into also passing on these stories. Fairy tales are a very good example of how this happens. Virtually all very old fairy tales, like the Grimm's fairy tales, have esoteric stories encoded into them symbolically, and a lot of them are stories about human psychology. And one of the ways that the tradition of these fairy tales was passed on was to present them in such a way that non-initiates would appreciate those stories and pass them on themselves. Now, each of these layers of knowledge can be discussed as separate disciplines, each of the four layers that I've described. But they also all overlap each other. And this is the deepest level of understanding the nature of the stories and the nature of the knowledge that they convey. The most serious level of training and understanding by experienced adepts is to understand how those four layers of collective psychology, history, personal psychology and alchemy can all overlap. And this is the deepest level because the lesson to be learned from that level of the overlapping of each of the layers of the story is that psychology, history and alchemy are all related. They are the same process functioning from different perspectives. Human history, actual people living out their lives on the planet, is an expression of the unfolding and development of the human mind. And that unfolding and development happens according to alchemical laws. So this ties together psychology, history, and alchemy into one process. So when we start to consider the subject of the Nakash, the subject of first importance for a Hermetic Kabbalist is the subject matter that we find in Genesis chapter 3. Which is the temptation of Adam and Eve by the serpent in the Garden of Eden. So, one of the most important tricks about encoding hidden information into esoteric or Kabbalistic or Hermetic stories and catechisms is the trick of playing with words. This is why Kabbalism and magic over thousands of years of history have always been associated with the manipulation of words and the way words are used in order to create magic effects, and why language in general is associated with the subject of Kabbalah and magic. And one of the ways that that aspect of esoteric knowledge is treated is that it is used for encoding information to be passed on down from teacher to student over the ages. So in looking at Genesis chapter 3, one of the first things that we're going to do is to start looking at the way that that story in chapter 3 is presented to us in common understanding is quite different than the way that the guys who originally produced that story understood its meaning. So let us start off with the word Nakash, the Hebrew word Nakash. We can see here in this diagram at the top that this is the spelling of the word in Hebrew, and it is spelled with the Hebrew letters Nun, Chet and Shin, or in English we would say N-C-H-S-H. Now, one of the things about Old Hebrew is that it had no vowels. In relatively modern times, that was compensated for by placing intonation and vocabulary marks above and below letters in order to indicate what vowel should be there, but original Hebrew and Aramaic had no vowels, it only had consonants. So the word spelled N-C-H-S-H is a primitive root word, And this root word can now be used to produce a number of other words by adding different vowels between the consonants, thus making the root word sound different in each variation. We can see here that the word nakash gets two letter A's between its consonants. There are other words using the same root word consonant system but with different vowels. But we're not going to look at those other words at the moment. We're just interested in the root word nakash with the vowels A twice repeated. In this way, each of the words that were produced out of the root word can be designed to have similar meanings or very different meanings, but either way, they're all linked together because they come from the original root word, and the original root word gives the core key meaning to all the other words that are developed out of the root word. So if I write a story with the idea N-C-H-S-H, nakash, used as a label for some concept, a naming word for some kind of concept, I write the word in Hebrew without vowels in the original text, and this is how original Hebrew texts were written. So the reader never really knows which one of the several words that are derived from the root word is meant by the word spelled N-C-H-S-H. But the common person is taught to understand the story using only one word version, one definition. The other definitions of the words in the story that can be used are kept secret, and they make up the esoteric understanding of the story. Anyone who is familiar with chapter 3 of Genesis knows that the common definition of the word, Hebrew word nakash, is translated into English as serpent. Now, you might not know that that's what the original Hebrew word is, but when you read chapter 3 and you see the word serpent, that is the definition, the common definition of the Hebrew word nakash, serpent or snake. This comes from the fact that the word nakash, without vowels in its root form, when pronounced, sounds something like a hissing noise, nakash. Because of this fact, the most basic definition of this word is snake. But any quick look at a Hebrew English dictionary, or more importantly, a Hebrew concordance, which is basically a dictionary which just translates biblical words, either Greek or Hebrew or both, will show you that the word nakash has several very curious definitions. Among these are whisperer, chanter, then enchanter, and sorcerer or magician. We can see that all of these ideas stem from the original concept of hissing and a serpent, because it is easy to see that a snake's hiss is kind of like a whisper. Similarly, the hiss whisper of a snake is kind of like a enchanting sing-song or a hypnotic kind of a whisper. Then, if we look further at the definitions for this word, the next level goes from enchanter to the definition prognosticator, or foreteller of the future, or in modern terminology, a clairvoyant. So it isn't hard to see that these various definitions flow out of each other and are linked together from that first definition of hissing and snake. If we look at the common definition nakash as serpent, then if we look at the last definition on that list as clairvoyant, those two things are actually quite far away from each other and they seem to be totally unrelated. But to a Kabbalist, they already understand the chain of the unfolding definitions, and they know how these two things are linked together. And therefore, in Kabbalistic word crafting, it is an acceptable situation to use the word nakash, hissing or serpent, to represent a clairvoyant or a sorcerer or an enchanter or a magician. So the common person reading chapter 3 of Genesis is never going to look at the part of the story where the serpent is chatting with Eve and trying to convince her to eat an apple from a tree and think that that serpent is actually a magician or an enchanter or a sorcerer or a clairvoyant. They're going to look at it as some kind of a weird sort of religious story where snakes can talk and hang out in trees and convince naked women to eat fruit that they've been told not to eat, which really is completely ridiculous and obviously is not to be taken literally, but is to be considered symbolically. And on another level below the symbolism is to be decoded into a completely different story. A story where the Kabbalist understands that the dialogue between Eve and the serpent is really a dialogue between a magician or an adept, a trained occultist, and a female human being, which then changes the whole flavor of the story in chapter 3. And it kind of reveals or allows us to see the statement that Christ made in the Gospels of "be ye wise as serpents." It allows us to understand that statement more clearly, because really, who expects snakes who squirm along the ground on their belly and hang out of trees to be wise? So he must have been referring to something else. He is referring to the wisdom of initiates, and it's commonly known, it's well known and understood that in ancient times initiates were known as serpents or dragons, and we can see that displayed in a lot of old Egyptian texts where we see hieroglyphs and drawings of interactions between common people and priests, that often advanced priests were shown as pictographs of serpents walking on feet and of serpents with wings, winged serpents. Understanding this fact shines a whole different picture on what the story in chapter 3 in Genesis looks like. So there are a few other words in chapter 3 in Genesis which we're now going to look at. We've already looked at the word nakash, and we understand that it could be translated as magician, sorcerer, clairvoyant, and by that an occultist. A hermetic student would understand that we're talking there about an adept, a trained occultist. So there are, before I discuss the whole of Genesis 3 and explain its meaning, there are a few other words that we're going to discuss the differences in definition with, and then I'm going to explain to you my version of how chapter 3 in Genesis would be read from an initiated Kabbalist's point of view. Okay, so the first word we want to look at is the word beast, which is used a couple of times in chapter 3. And the word beast in verse 1 of chapter 3, the serpent is more cunning than any beast of the field. That word in Hebrew is spelled like this and is pronounced she. Now, apart from the definition of beast, the Hebrew word chay can also mean renewed, restored, or resurrected one. It also is closely associated with the ideas of living, or alive, or of life force, which is a very different understanding from the word beast. The basic definition of the word he or he is beast because it refers to a living thing, and it has been translated as meaning beast. But it also can refer to renewed, restored, or resurrected, or enlivened, or living individual or person or things. The next word to consider is the word Elohim, which is commonly translated as God in the singular. But in actual fact, the word Elohim can be understood as in the plural, meaning gods, but that is by far not the most common or the only definition of the word Elohim. Amongst many other definitions for that word are the term magistrates or judges, or a person who is discerns things or decides things. So, for example, in the judicial system in ancient Judea or amongst the Hebrews, a magistrate of a court or a judge could be referred to as Elohim. But the word was also used to refer to God or gods, but also angels, also a place where sacred things happened, or to sacred objects in that place. So there is, again, a very wide range of definitions, and the translators, the original Kabbalists who wrote these texts and then described them to common people, only presented one view. And the people who translated the Hebrew into Latin and then the Latin into English, or the Hebrew into English, took that common translation and ignored all the other translations, possible definitions of these words. So chapter 3 also talks about Jehovah Elohim, and that is translated into English most commonly as the Lord God. So Elohim, God. And they're translating the word Jehovah, which is the common name of the God of the Hebrews, or the God of the Jews. They're translating that word because one of its definitions is Lord, which basically means like governor or overseer. So the term Jehovah Elohim can actually be translated as Lord Judge, or Lord Magistrate, or Chief Judge or Magistrate, or Chief Overseer, Chief Person who makes decisions about things. The next word is the word tree, and everybody knows that chapter 3 discusses the idea of two trees in particular in the Garden of Eden, the tree of knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life. And God laid down very particular rules about these trees to Adam and Eve and said you're allowed to eat of certain things and not eat of other things and so on. But the word tree in Hebrew is pronounced eats or eats. And one of the definitions for that word is teacher or righteous one or upright one or wise elder. So, for example, there's a certain place in the Bible that speaks of the cedars of Lebanon, which were renowned in ancient times. And that statement on one level isn't referring to forests or particular trees that are planted on hillsides or whatever, it is referring to teachers and a particular kind of teacher, and that these teachers were of old men of renown. So that's the word tree. One of the ways of defining the meaning of that word is that it can mean teacher. And it can also refer to a carpenter. The word carpenter is tied up with the word tree and with the word teacher. And again, reflects back to the concept of adepts and esoteric teachers. And if we look at the concept of carpenter as being an encoded definition for the word of esoteric teacher, that then makes us look at Jesus's father and Jesus himself in a different light, because supposedly Jesus's father was a carpenter. It could mean that he was actually a teacher of esoteric knowledge. So there are a whole bunch of different meanings for these various words, and the last ones I want to discuss here is the word eat. And one of the, apart from obvious things like the word eat means to devour flesh or vegetables or fruit or whatever, it also then starts shifting to definitions such as consume. And then from there, it can be defined as meaning to learn or to take into yourself or to accept or to be taught or educated. So, there are very different meanings for these various words. So we can see just from these few words I've given examples for how varied their definitions can be, that a very different story of chapter 3 in Genesis starts to unfold. And that story speaks about an adept who is discussing and debating learning of certain kind of information that overseers and or a chief overseer has ruled that Adam and Eve are not supposed to have access to. So I have taken the initiative and have written up my own version of a hermetic interpretation of chapter 3. And so I'm going to quote that entire chapter in my interpretation, the hermetic interpretation now, and we need to take into consideration that we're translating into esoteric language texts that have survived for thousands of years and have undergone a lot of oral tradition as well as written tradition, and therefore have been affected by translation, interpretation, transcription. And so this is really just a rough translation from the common understanding into an esoteric standing of chapter 3 of Genesis. But I think it at least gives an idea of how the old Kabbalists might have looked at the subject of how to form these symbolic stories and the kinds of information that was hidden in them. So chapter 3 of Genesis, verse 1. And there was an adept who had wisdom above every illuminated adept, who was a dweller in the house of the initiated, which the chief overseer had established. And that adept asked boldly of the human female, "Is it correct that the overseers commanded that you shall not be initiated by any adept teacher who is in the house of the initiated?" Verse 2. And the female replied to the illuminated adept, "Of the esoteric benefits of the adept teachers of the house of the overseers, we are allowed to be educated." verse 3. But the esoteric benefits of the adept teachers who are part of the inner college in the house of the overseers, it is said to us by the overseers, you are not allowed to be learned of that knowledge, nor of that knowledge shall you practice, lest through that knowledge you cut yourself off from the higher realms. Verse 4. And so the adept boldly said to the female, you most definitely will not be cut off from the higher realms, because the overseers know that in the bigger picture, when you learn that knowledge, your awareness will be opened into the physical realm, wherein you, just like the overseers, will grasp the nature of binary reality in the lower world. Verse 5. And she realized, that female, how beneficial would be the adept teacher's instruction in binary reality, and that it was much prized, that experience of binary reality, much prized in the search for wisdom. So the female received the benefits of that secret knowledge and became wise concerning binary reality. And then she gave access to that knowledge also to her partner, the man, and he became learned in it too. Verse 6. In this way, they also became aware of the binary nature of each other. And in this way, they perceived they had become educated just like their adept teacher. And so they tailored a body of secret knowledge out of physical existence and thereby became ensnared by that education process. Verse 7. Then they became aware of the inner voice of the chief overseer, his command in the part of their mind which is eternal, in the realm of the overseers. So the male and female hid themselves from the presence of the chief overseer in the confines of the inner college of the adepts in the realm of the overseers. Verse 8. And the chief overseer called by name the male and asked him, where are you? And the male replied, your call, I did hear it in the house of the overseers. But I was worried because I have received instruction from the adepts, so I hid from you. Verse 9. And the chief overseer replied, who instructed you in self-knowledge, which is the privilege of the adepti, which I had forbidden you to be instructed in, but which you now have? Verse 10. Replying, the male said, the female, who you gave me to be my mate, it was she that gave me access to the adept teacher, and I accepted his instruction. Verse 11. And the chief overseer asked the female, what have you done? And replying, the female said, the adept teacher tricked me, and thereby I became his student. Verse 12. The chief overseer then said to the adept teacher, because you have done this, I declare you outcast. You, as one of the illuminated adepts, in the realm of the overseers, from the womb shall thou enter the lower realm, where you shall be forced to attain the immortality that you seek through the struggle of incarnatory initiation through binary reality. Verse 13. And hostility I will establish between yourself and the female, and between your initiates and her offspring, Her offspring will not tolerate the rulers among your initiates, and you shall have no tolerance for their journey in life. Verse 14. And the female, to her he said, I will amplify your sorrow, and childbirth will be a painful thing for you if you should give birth to sons, and your male partner will be desirable to you, but he shall rule over you. Verse 15. To the male, the chief overseer said, because you listened to the advice of the female and became a student of the adept teacher, which I commanded you, saying, you are not allowed to take their instruction. The realm of incarnation will be, because of your misbehavior, a realm of sorrow, and you will get your education now through reincarnation for as many lives as it takes to eventually become illuminated and immortal. Verse 16. Through the hard work of your lower personality, so shall you gain your esoteric education. In order to be emancipated, you will migrate between the eternal world and then return to the lower world over and over. You developed what you now are in the lower world, therefore of the lower nature you are, and to the lower nature you shall return. Verse 17. And the male called the name of his wife Eve, or life giver, because she became the mother of all incarnate humans. Verse 18. And the chief overseer caused the male and his female to forget the self-knowledge they had previously learned, and incarnated them in bodies of warmed, wet earth. Verse 19. And the chief overseer exclaimed, behold, the male has become one of us, knowing the nature of binary law. Therefore, lest he develop his power further by receiving the rank of adept illuminate and thereby learn the secret of the elixir of life and become immortal, he shall be forced into a cycle of reincarnation. Verse 20. Therefore the chief overseer cast out of the realm of the chief overseer, called the enclosure of the initiates, into the slavery of the cycle of incarnation, from which man became what he now is. And we'll stop my interpretation and quotation at that point. So I've obviously used quite a bit of artistic license in that interpretation, but it's necessary in order to convert the common understanding of Genesis chapter 3 into the esoteric interpretation of that chapter. Now, it's impossible to say originally how much artistic license Kabbalistic adepts would have used when they were providing this interpretation to their students, whether there was an older versions of the Gospels, of the Old Testament, there may have been a more accurate direct interpretation, but that really isn't the point. The point is, when you understand the Hebrew text, original text, and you understand the English translation of the original Hebrew text, and you have a Hebrew concordance and a Hebrew dictionary at hand, it becomes very obvious that there are a number of ways of interpreting all of the texts in the Bible, all of the texts in the Bible, and therefore it is completely reasonable to accept that there were people who had quite a different understanding of the Bible than the literal or common interpretation that is had today. So we can see here that the story that is being described is basically symbolic, partly symbolic, but also kind of in a way a quite literal description of how human beings might have first got their hands on occult knowledge. And that the story says that there was an adept or a school of adepts who were of the opinion that humanity should get access to esoteric knowledge. But there was another class of being, which I have named the overseers, you know, the Elohim, judges, overseers, the discerners, the people who make the decisions, the entities or the creatures or the intelligences who make the decisions. I've translated that as overseer. That the overseers originally didn't want humanity having access to esoteric knowledge. Like, that's it. They're going to stay the way they are, and that's the end of it. But an initiated individual or a school of initiates or some kind of a situation where there were more advanced spiritual intelligences decided to overthrow that decision to not initiate human beings and took it upon themselves to force humanity to gain initiatory knowledge by entering into intimate experience with physical reality, with what I often refer to as binary reality. And then when the overseers discovered that this had happened, there was a bunch of punishments dished out to the adept teacher, to the woman, and to the man. And basically, the punishment comes down to, since you have poked your nose into binary reality, in order to gain specialized knowledge from that experience, I'm going to create a situation now where you have to incarnate into binary reality and live through multiple incarnations there in order to get what you were originally after, which was immortality and illumination. So now you're not going to get it the easy way, you're going to have to go through it the hard way. Because, and this is kind of like the summation at the end of chapter 3, since you have knowledge of the secrets of binary reality, the next thing you can now possibly do is get your hands on knowledge of how to be illuminated and live eternally, which would make you equal to us, the overseers, the Elohim, and which was referred to in the common understanding of chapter 3 as the tree of life. And we know that the tree of life is the primary label for the system which is the center of Kabbalistic teaching. So we know that the tree of life is a symbol in the Garden of Eden, is a symbol for esoteric education of a particular kind. So now we see a kind of a complete turnaround where the serpent in the Old Testament is seen as bad and has caused humanity to fall into physical existence as a kind of a punishment for sin. But the esoteric version of that story says that actually that serpent or advanced adept was doing humanity a favor that was outside of the rules of some kind of higher species of being that didn't want human beings to be esoterically educated, didn't want them to be illuminated, and didn't want them to gain immortality. So the role of the serpent has switched 180 degrees, which is a very controversial subject, and why we can therefore understand that Kabbalists and initiates down through the ages have wanted that information to be kept secret. Now, I'm not saying that that interpretation of the Old Testament is fact. What I'm saying is that this is what Kabbalists, or at least a certain school or schools of Kabbalists, believed was fact. And this is what they accepted as part of their esoteric education and passed on as part of their esoteric education. But we're going to look more deeply into the mechanics of human psychology and initiation and all that as the podcasts unfold. And I'm going to leave you to make up your own decision about how accurate you think this story at the beginning of the Old Testament is about what Kabbalists believe that original human initiators' motives really were. In relation to this serpent adept teacher, in the story, he basically then is the first initiator of humanity. In ancient Egyptian esoteric tradition, in other words, the Hermetic tradition, that individual is known as the god Thoth or Dejuti, and it is said as part of the esoteric tradition that the role that that god played, Thoth, played in the evolution of humanity was that he was the guy who taught human beings language, who also taught them science and magic. And so Thoth is the Egyptian version of that Kabbalistic Nakash. He was the guy who allowed human beings to be exposed to esoteric knowledge. So this serpent adept teacher in the Hermetic tradition is referred to as the guardian of the mysteries, who also holds the keys to those mysteries. So that adept traditionally has the role of deciding who gets into that esoteric knowledge and who doesn't. This is an important part of the characteristic of the Nakash, as spoken of in traditional secret Kabbalistic teaching. And we're going to talk about that particular subject a lot over the coming podcasts, that the Nakash plays the role of the guardian of the gate into the Temple of the Mysteries, and that the Nakash holds the keys to that gate. And that this was one of the core secrets of ancient esoteric teaching, and it is a key part of the Hermetic tradition. From the story in chapter 3, we also understand that reincarnation is actually a part of the initiatory process, that the overseers or the chief overseer insisted that in order to be able to gain illumination and immortality, it was first necessary for human beings to reincarnate as a form of education. So this is one of the things that is very different from the Western tradition in comparison to the Eastern tradition, where the Eastern tradition basically says that physical life is an illusion and is something that needs to be escaped from as soon as possible. In the Western tradition, it is taught that physical life is a very important part of a human being's necessary education in order to responsibly then be able to gain a state of spiritual illumination. So far from being an illusion and unimportant and something that needs to be avoided, living through multiple incarnations in order to understand the real nature of binary existence is a core part of the spiritual journey of human beings. And that at the end of reincarnation, at the end of that education about binary existence, then the properly prepared human being, the properly educated human being, enters into an initiatory education, which is a higher level of esoteric training, which then leads to a state of spiritual emancipation and spiritual illumination. So that adept teacher and the human beings that have been educated in binary existence are referred to in the esoteric interpretation of chapter 3 as the restored ones, or the renewed ones, or the ones who have regained life or access to eternal life. In other words, they are resurrected. They have gone through the hermetic initiatory process of the death of the lower self and the rebirth into the higher self, the higher nature. We're going to cover a lot of detail about the mechanism of that process in later podcasts. In the interpretation of, in the understanding of chapter 3, the Nakash then, on the level of personal human psychology, is what we know as the Jungian shadow, the intelligence in us that is responsible for keeping our mind and our consciousness, our awareness, anchored in physical reality, in binary reality. In fact, in classic Kabbalah, that Nakash has, one of the titles that it has is the dual contending forces. And that label refers to the fact that the Nakash, as the shadow of the human being, is the thing in us which keeps our awareness anchored in physical life. So the mystery of the Nakash rightly belongs to the opening phase of the initiation process. In alchemy, that opening phase is known as the negredo, or the blackness. And there's a very famous saying amongst alchemists that our work, meaning the great work of alchemy, our work begins in darkness and in death. And this is why the Nakash is related to the idea of darkness and death. So thanks very much for listening to this podcast again. The next podcast will be on the subject of the Nefesh, or the unconscious mind. And we will be elaborating a little more on the subject of the Nakash at the same time, because the Nefesh, or the unconscious mind, has a very close relationship with the intelligence, or the part Sufi, which is the Nakash.